Hello. I'm Steven. All right. So senior year of high school wasn't the greatest year for me. Senioritis struck hard. Homework never got completed. My grades weren't my most outstanding feature. If not grades, then maybe sports. Nope. I did wrestling and football during freshman year, but that was when I had all my friends with me to fuel motivation and make it fun. Then I moved from Phoenix, Arizona to sunny San Diego, and I lost all my best friends and my sense of status in school. I wasn't a loner, and I had an established set of friends from middle school. They became the jocks of high school, and I'd get to hang out with them. Making friends was a perk just for being around them. It was awesome. I was popular. But then the move came. I had to start all over again, making friends, meet new people, and fit in. Only thing is, I hate talking to people. It's really hard for me. I'm really shy. So meeting new people is nearly impossible for me. And public speaking, such a drag, I swear to God. But by the time I had gotten to my senior year, I had a trial and error type of experience with the friends and girlfriends over here. I either didn't share the same interests with these group of kids, or another group of kids wouldn't talk to me and let me stand there awkwardly. I didn't really fit in with anybody. I was the outcast at my school. I met a few girls, but none that really stuck with me. I was really struggling with socialization. My final outcome was a little over 100 Facebook friends and these two guys I occasionally hang out with. And the love of my life. Yeah, this kid, he's only 18, and he said the love of his life. But her name was Mariana, and she was the most incredible, lovely person I have ever met. So she treated me like I was the only person that mattered in the world and made me feel happy, even through my depression. Yes, major depression. Had it ever since I moved 3 years ago. You can't just take that kind of loss and not go a little crazy. I was having severe anxiety and clinical depression, and Mariana really helped me through it. When I was with her, I would forget that I was so messed up. Unfortunately, by the beginning of my senior year, she was already my ex. I broke up with her from all the imaginary things I thought she was thinking or doing. Like, I would think she's talking to other boys because she's not interested in me anymore. Or she was leaving to Colorado for the summer only to get away from me. I had serious separation anxiety with her. She became a crutch at that point. I spent more time in fear losing her rather than appreciating her time with me. It was probably a chronic fear of abandonment I developed from losing all my friends from Arizona. If my social life wasn't bad enough already, I still had this serious guilt of not being good enough for my dad. I just wanted to be the best son I could be for him, but it was so hard with my mental illnesses sabotaging everything. I'm not sure where my desire to be this great son came from. I just felt like I wasn't approved for anything I was proud of, other than wrestling, because I was actually good at it. But when I tried joining the wrestling team over here, it just wasn't the same, and it was just pain. I ended up quitting and feeling like a loser. I wanted to be seen by my father as the star child, but I was blowing it. So all of senior year was going pretty bad. I would go to school doped up on pills, bear with the classes, avoid Mariana as much as possible, avoid anyone associated with her, try not to think about it a lot, and wear a smile. Didn't want the world to know I was hating everything. I'd be avoided at all costs. People don't want to hang around with such negativity. Therapy and medication weren't helping much, so I figured I'd find a way to fix it. At least some of it. 2 years of that crap, and then the added loss, I was on a downward spiral with no end in sight. I was in a world of shit. It wasn't until fall break, about a year ago today, where I caught a break. One morning, I woke up to a notification that says, Tony Punisher, my brother-in-law, had beat my high score in Diamond Dash. So naturally, I go and meet his challenge, but it seems he had bested me. Try after try. I couldn't manage to regain my throne. It wasn't even that much higher than my score, but I couldn't top it. I had lost something again. It had become this recurring theme in my life. So angrily, I started blaming myself for sucking at everything. School, sports, people, games, just anything I did. The snowball effect. After beating myself up over Diamond Dash, I had this sudden realization. And that was it. I had thought up the master plan that would solve everything. An ace in the hole. Why didn't I think of this sooner? I don't know. Maybe it was too simple to see in all of my overthinking, but I had the idea now. That was all that mattered. I finally found a way to solve all my troubles. A feeling of relief washed over me. I was out of the fog and in the clear. All that was left to do now was act. First things first, I need an extension cord. Without one, it just wouldn't work. But do we even have an extension cord in the house? I thought, so I jumped off my bed and started searching the house. I made a mess of the closets, the cabinets, under the sink, the hallway cabinets, the garage, nothing. My next thoughts were, why the hell don't we have an extension cord in the house? So maybe I'll just go to the hardware store and buy one. No, I was grounded for fighting my brother. It was worth it, though. He had it coming. So I couldn't leave the house, especially with my mother on the way home from work. I wouldn't make it back in time. Time is running out, and this plan had a small window of opportunity. It had to be now. I just couldn't handle any more time. No more heartache, no more struggling with my grades, and no more feeling like I'm letting my father down. No more pain. I had to fix it now. I had to improvise. I only had to cover about 5 feet to reach the bathtub. I went back to my room to think about what would work at that moment. I see the power strip. I figured if I got enough power strips and connected them together, it would reach the bathtub from the outlet in the hallway. So I run around my house, unplugging all the power strips. I got 4 of them all together, one from the computer in the living room, another from my parents' room, my room, and the living room TV. I connected them all into one long cord and connected the one at the end into the outlet in the hallway. And it just reached outside the tub, but that was fine because the toaster had its own cord. I started filling the tub with water and went to the kitchen to go get the toaster. I felt so relieved. All my troubles were going to be gone soon. Only thing left to do is plug in the toaster and get in the tub. I was in the tub, fully clothed, toaster in hand, my head wrapped with a towel, with a piece of it in my mouth so I wouldn't break my teeth as I clenched them from the shock. You see, electrocompulsive therapy patients, they always wear a mouth guard, so I figured I needed to do the same for my much more permanent treatment. I couldn't be an ugly corpse. Didn't want my mom coming home to a bloody mess. Well, I guess having her come home to a dead son doesn't sound too good either, but it was either now or never. The toaster was on. The next step was to lower it into the water and set myself free from the wretched clutches of depression. Relief was only 3 inches away. I felt my heart pounding, as it is now. And I knew this was it. Depression won't rule my life anymore. And I was going to take it out once and for all. I will not live with it anymore. I've had enough. But then I hesitated. My mind started racing. What if it hurts a lot? My eyes would probably explode. This is going to be messy. I can't stop now. There's any going back. I'm in trouble. I can't do this. I heard the front door open. Oh, fuck, I said. I heard my mom say, "Are you in the bathroom? What are you doing?" Guessing she's seen the power strips by now, and then knocked on the door, pushing it open at the same time, hoping it wasn't what she thought. My mom was the first to know about my depression. I trusted her most with my emotions, but this time the pain just hurt more than I cared about how she'd react to finding me. When she saw me in the tub, she screamed, "Steven, no! No, my boy!" You know, but like a little more dramatic than I did. She ran into the house screaming for help. During her momentary panic frenzy, she couldn't make sense of the scene. I had the toaster set on the side, but at that moment, though, I felt as if I did kill myself, and I got to see how they'd react. In a strange sense, I felt like a ghost. It was surreal. It was painful. All I could think was, what have I done? I felt like a monster to put his own mother through that pain. I knew it would hurt her beforehand, but the pain was so unbearable. Nothing was working, therapy, antidepressants, the coping skills. I just saw no other option. I cared more about ending the pain than I did about how they'd feel. This is supposed to end all my problems. Ironically enough, it only created more. My neighbors sprinted into the house after hearing my mother's screams. They ran into the bathroom so fast they knocked over my cat's litter box and made a mess of the bathroom. Luckily for me, they didn't drop the toast into the water. That would have been shocking. I was more shocked to see their sense of urgency. They didn't even know me. One of them looked like he was working out because he was shirtless with his running shoes on. At that moment, I died from embarrassment. Everything was prepped and ready to go. They thought I was dead too. So they unplugged the power strip from the hall and gave me a poke. The whole time, I was sitting still in the cold water in the tub with the towel over my head because I didn't really know what to do. I was cold and ashamed. I just froze. There wasn't any excuse I could think of to get me out of that situation. I'm sure saying, hey guys, this might look bad, but I assure you, I was just making Pop-Tarts. And trying to cool down. They wouldn't have bought it. So I just sobbed and played the part of the sad teen. They pulled me out of the tub and wrapped me in a towel. Then I got the usual rundown of questions. Are you okay? Why did you do it? Why didn't you tell anyone you were feeling that way? I just didn't say anything. They ended up calling the police. Literally, they called the police. One was on a cell phone. The other used my house phone. People. Two cops showed up. One went to investigate the house, and the other questioned me. While the officer was questioning me, I heard my neighbors talking to each other, sharing their experience about what they thought of the whole thing. I remember them saying, I haven't ran that fast in a while. The other said, yeah, I thought something bad had happened. I felt like my situation was belittled, and that made me really angry. How dare they have an opinion? Just complete irrational anger thoughts. Then the police saw my setup in the bathroom. I was placed on suicide watch. The officer told me I was going to the emergency room, as in I had no choice. I asked if I could change out of my wet clothes. They allowed it, but they didn't give me any privacy, not after what I pulled. Everything was against me at this point. He followed me to my room and just stood there. I changed, but I had my wet underwear on still. After finished changing, I was handcuffed and escorted to the back of the police car. It was unnecessary. I thought it made me look crazy. I mean, I guess I was, but to be handcuffed in front of my neighborhood and the walk of the shame to the cop car, it was insult to injury. My mom told me she'd meet me at the hospital, but I didn't really want her to go. I felt too ashamed. The officer said he was transporting a 5150 to the hospital. I knew it meant crazy and violent from all the video games I've been playing, so I asked the officer what that meant, just to see what he'd say. And he responded, it means you're a hazard to yourself and potentially others, which I thought that was a nice way of putting it. And it was true. It really slipped my mind that if my mom would have tried to save me, if I had gone through with it, she would have been electrocuted too. I just felt worse, like the world's biggest asshole. I had to explain myself at the emergency room to the hospital psychologist. She was an old woman who was like, oh, another one of these kids. How did you get here? Haven't you been seeing a therapist? You're only 18. What problems could you possibly have? Everything she said made me feel horrible. She decided I belonged in a psychiatric facility till I was stable and able to live safely. Didn't give me much of a choice either. She asked me, if I were to go home, would I feel safe? I said, I think so. Which was the wrong answer, apparently, because she said, right. before you go home, you have to spend some time in our psych ward, so you learn some skills to better manage your depression. But before I went to the mental ward, which was a really bad place, I had no rights, everything I said was assumed a lie, no locks, and only one exit that was open from the nurse's office felt like jail. So I had to wait about 2 hours for the ambulance before I was escorted to that wonderful place. While waiting, my family decided to show up and try to talk to me. They only let them in one at a time, which was weird and grueling. They were escorted by a nurse into the room, and once the nurse left, they'd spill their guts on me. I sat in the corner of the room because it was the farthest I could have possibly been from them. I felt exposed, and I had to take every talk. When they finished, they told me so-and-so wanted to talk to me next, and the nurse would walk them out. They all asked, "Why did you do it?" or "How could you do that to us?" I felt their pain, like trembling in their voice, the tears, the crying, but I had no real answers for them other than I was depressed and wanted the pain to end. They didn't want to accept the answer, but I don't think they really expected an answer. My father's meet and greet was the only meeting that really stuck with me. That one hurt the most. I felt as if I really fucked up as a son. With all the bad grades, no outstanding sports performance, no wonderful girl to boast about, I just had nothing to impress him with, and all I really wanted to do was impress my father and gain his approval for something I had done. But attempting to kill myself, probably the last thing he'd want. What made the meeting so bad is that he didn't say anything. I was sitting in my corner and he was leaning against the hospital bed. He took one deep sigh and started looking around the room. I just stared at my feet, thinking and speaking for my father in my head. "I'm so disappointed in you. You know better than this. Do you just want attention? If you really wanted to cure yourself, you would have just done it. What are you doing with yourself?" Basically beating myself up. But the truth was, he never thought any of that. He's told me in the past that he didn't expect anything from me. He already had my approval. There is nothing I could do to lose his love. But I built up the nerve to ask, "What are you thinking?" And he said, "What does it matter?" He had hit me with my own ammunition. Those bullets tore right through my soul. They still do. It was the worst pain I ever felt. As I was sitting there in the tub, everything my parents and my family had tried to do to help me, it didn't matter to me. It didn't matter to me at all. Now what seemed like a way out had just become an invalid option. I couldn't possibly try to kill myself again. I couldn't put my family through that again. I had to get better. I had to, for them.